One gets after this renormalization dependence, dependence of effective temperature. So that depending on this cutoff, one will have equations for effective temperature. That's what one does always in the renormalization group. So then I have to give you this renormalization, show this renormalization group equations. So this effective temperature, this is this effective temperature T, and then Xi is just a running logarithmic variable. So running logarithmic variable means that we change this cutoff K and introduce Xi is equal to logarithm of K, K naught somehow. We integrate in some momentum shell, then we reduce system to smaller moment and so on. And then we see what happens when we try to integrate everything. So, and then one gets in the first loop approximation, one gets this equation. This is standard for renormalization for many sigma models. For example, the same type of equation one gets for two-dimensional localization, two-dimensional O3 model, somehow two-dimensional classical ferromagnet, and so on. And just this, in the second loop, just this equation. And it has the solution. Solution is simple. In principle, one can write almost immediately this solution for temperature. So let us say that this is some upper cutoff, upper momentum cutoff. This could be some running cutoff. This K naught. And we see that the effective temperature grows. So as we go to lower momenta, or you go to larger and larger distances, effective temperature grows. So this effect has been first noticed by Sasha Polyakov, who really did it for SON model, as I remember. So this means the following. Of course, all this approximation, one loop approximation, is valid only when this parameter T effective is small. So which means that if you start with some low temperatures, T naught, and then do it this renormalization group, as a result of this flow, this effective T grows. This means that these fluctuations serve as disorder the ordered state. So at the zero temperature, one can imagine that one has all matrices U parallel to each other, or spins parallel to each other. But then temperature leads to disordering the system. And in principle, one should make cutoff, this process stops as soon as this bare parameter kappa, as soon as one reaches the scale of this kappa. This kappa is inverse length. Or, see if kappa originally is low enough, or there is possibility that this logarithm is large, then when it becomes of the close to unity, this T becomes of the order of unity, and then simply first loop approximation, one loop approximation is no longer valid. So it is, from the beginning, it was interpreted as if the temperature goes to infinity somehow, which means that you, for any temperature, you have no long range order. So the system is disordered. So for any finite temperature, if you have isotropic system, so temperature went up to infinity effective temperature, which means that you don't have phase transition in O3 model or any such kind of model. You don't have transition in two dimensions. This long range order is absent always. So this means that if we start with this model, this degeneracy between superconductivity and charge modulation, if this degeneracy is really perfect and the system, the mean field gives you equally charge order or superconductivity, then this order, either of these orders, so is lost. So long range order disappears. So this means that from this equation we conclude that there is possibility that one gets into such a state that so you have mixture of disorders and strongly fluctuating, and these fluctuations are so strong that you don't have any long range order, only short range order. Moreover, kappa is renormalized. This anisotropy is renormalized. And in contrast to temperature, this effective anisotropy parameter just goes to zero, not to infinity, just decreases. So this means physically that if you start with small anisotropy between disorders, so that superconductivity is more preferable than charge modulation, but not so much more preferable, then fluctuations drive the system to such a situation that it becomes perfectly isotropic and temperature goes to infinity. And this means that there can be a phase transition, which means at low temperatures you get, for example, superconductivity, just this somehow T naught is so small that T effective cannot become large, so T naught is small. But if you increase your temperature, then you get finally the possibility that this reaches unity or close to unity, and this would mean the phase transition. So what happens at this phase transition? The system loses any anisotropy between superconductor and charge modulation. At the same time, the fluctuations due to this zero anisotropy become so strong that you lose any long range order. So that's the result of this study of fluctuations. So,
excuse me. In presence of the anisotropy, is there some symmetry left? Or
no, if kappa is large enough, anisotropy, initial anisotropy is.
Yeah, is there some symmetry left in you, or is it SU2 is SU2 fully broken by this anisotropy?
No, not fully, because
there's some superconducting phase left.
Phase, of course, so the degeneracy, yes. A super phase of degeneracy to superconducting phase is left, and also degeneracy on the position of this modulation, charge modulation is left. So two phases are left, but just this what is more favorable, superconductivity or charge modulation, this degeneracy is killed from the beginning, but there can be situation at sufficiently high temperatures that this isotropy is again somehow established. So the fluctuations are so strong that effectively this anisotropy is lost. It is lost not as crossover, there should be some transition temperature when it gets completely lost. So, and one can estimate this transition temperature. And so that this is logarithm. If kappa is initial very small, then it can be reached at lower temperatures. The larger kappa, the lower the transition. So the smaller kappa, the lower the transition temperature. So therefore, this situation of this extremely strong fluctuation is some kind of new state. So nobody has spoken about such state in terms of for this ITC business. And if one assumes that this really happens, that one comes to such a picture that how one can visualize. So if we can have the axis of quadrupole density wave and superconductivity. So superconductivity is, so as I written, yes, it is written here, superconductivity is when theta is equal to zero, then superconductivity corresponds to this matrix element. If you are in the quadrupole density wave, you have theta pi half, and then you have only this matrix elements. So usually if we consider the system, if a Fermi surface has some curvature, then this theta equals to zero is more favorable. This is corresponds just to the positive sign of kappa squared. Otherwise, it would be different. So therefore, on this language, superconductivity is just theta equals zero. Quadrupole density wave, it is theta is equal to pi half. And what is pseudo gap state? It is this vector, which is either along superconducting axis or along QDW axis. But in the pseudo gap state, this vector starts homogeneously fluctuating between superconductivity and QDW. This is such a state that you have this almost homogeneous fluctuations of this vector, and you lose a long range order, although short range order exists, and you may have, and this is long range order, it is a symbiosis of these two, QDW and superconductivity, and then it fluctuates, and you have this interesting state. So this was our a prediction what happens, and I guess it was completely new prediction. I'm not aware about anybody who would spoke about this pseudo gap state in such terms. This means in particular that there is no sharp boundary between between this pseudo gap state and normal metal, because long range order doesn't exist anyway, and therefore it is only a smooth crossover between this pseudo gap state and normal metal. So now, then we have drawn from our calculations, we have drawn the following picture. It is, there was a big misunderstanding in the beginning, because we wanted to say from the beginning that we didn't study coup rates and didn't want to intervene into this business with 10 to the 5 publications. But we want to study this critical behavior, quantum criticality. And suddenly, at the end, we got this picture. So suppose that we had antiferromagnet, it has been destroyed. What is important for us, it was important that the system is two-dimensional. Then we do not know what happens just here. Sorry. This line is the line of existence of this antiferromagnetic without interaction between this critical mode and electrons. If we didn't switch on the interaction, we would have this picture of antiferromagnet. So this is the boundary of the antiferromagnet. However, we switch on this interaction and we get mean field solution. This is something like here. We have the critical temperature of the mean field solution, and this is a mean field. Then we study fluctuations, and our prediction is that here we get this pseudo gap state, which is extremely strongly fluctuating, no long range order. Here there is crossover, and this temperature is something like several hundred Kelvin. And then we have here transition to the superconductivity. Then we worked all the time to from the right of the transition. If we go to the left, still there can be competition between this charge modulation, superconductivity, but also antiferromagnetism. And how it is destroyed here and what is in this region, it is question mark, it means simply that we have not had time to study that. So and after we have written the paper and showing this picture, then there was big misunderstanding because people thought that we just try to describe real coup rates, and then there were questions.
We are doing now.
So we are forced, we are driven to comparing with coup rates. In the beginning, we were trying to play that game, so we studied just the model. And surprisingly, this model really gives quite a lot, it really explains quite a lot of features of coup rates. And you devote some time to discussing of the experiments. And therefore, so although not thinking in that terms in the beginning that it could be relevant to coup rates, we were driven, so in that sense we were really honest in studying a theoretical model without thinking much how this detail should be related to some experimental fact. And then we had problems because people were asking questions, how can one support that directly experimentally. So of course we have drawn this diagram, and then it didn't mean much for people who worked for a couple decades on coup rates, and therefore there were many different questions, and the main question was how can one directly support this picture. Okay, this is of course somehow support, direct support, but one would like to see just experiment and our prediction and somehow direct comparison. And we were quite lucky. Yeah.
Sorry again. About the red dotted line, how do you get a finite temperature transition here if you are in 2D? You put it by hand?
The temperature of what?
The nail temperature in absence of electrons. Red dotted line.
Okay, this was in our model, this was just in the model, this was just this D, and one has this parameter A. This is critical mode. So in our model, this dashed line corresponds to the temperature when A turns to zero. So our assumption was we assumed that A is equal to zero at the transition or positive. And we have not considered the case when it is negative. So in that sense, this dashed line means the transition, that it is just the temperature when A.
But the question is, you are in two or three dimensions, you should be in three dimensions.
In principle, yes, there is of course.
And you work in two dimensions.
No, once more. You mean theoretically or experimentally?
Theoretically.
So once more, all our calculations are in two dimensions, and plus temperature, 2 plus 1. If we worked in three dimensions, we wouldn't get that. So
But in experiment, you are in three dimensions.
It is extremely, so the coupling between layers is quite weak. So that's okay, one.
So if I understand correctly, you don't really see the magnetic order, but you adjust by A somehow some gap to the magnons by hand. And when it's
so low, we say that we cannot calculate the transition antiferromagnet normal metal transition. Suppose that it exists, which is easily accepted. And then in this model it exists as the point where A turns to zero. And we study A equals zero or positive. Study negative is possible, but we have not done that. So otherwise everything is consistent. And again, this this dashed line is also very much confusion for experimentalists because they do not understand this question, because experimentally you don't see that. This dashed line, it is starting point for theoretical analysis. And therefore
it's true to say that we didn't study on the left of this.
We didn't study. But again, for experimentalists, what is this dashed line? They don't see
I agree. This is very
confusing. So, but this is a real phase diagram of our theory. And then we compare it with experiments. Okay, now then the question, this charge modulation. And if we had done our work 1 year earlier, then we would have trouble to convince people that it is has something in common with reality. But we were just lucky. Okay, still this scanning tunnel in microscopy, it was a somewhat earlier study. I don't know, but in that time still people thought in terms of stripes and so on. And there were such stripes seen, and this was a combination of charge and spin modulation. In STM, one couldn't distinguish really between spin and charge very well, and therefore many people have seen in STM some modulations, but attributed to stripes, and maybe this was first clear statement that this is charge density wave observed using STM. And this was done in the group of Hudson, who was tenure track in MIT, but after completing all this work and getting these results, he didn't get tenure in MIT, because apparently at that time it was still too strong statement to say that this was checkerboard. So our structure is checkerboard, not stripe. At that time it was allowed to speak only in terms of stripes. So this statement, he considered different values of this X, I believe, which meant different doping level. And so he found that there is some structure at wave vector which was the same for different temperatures. Or it was different for different doping levels, but it was not temperature dependent. In that time, so it was only 5 years ago, but in that time still it was a too strong statement. Moreover, he compared this modulation with some characteristic vectors of charge density wave of Fermi surface, and his claim was that the period of modulation was more or less such a vector. And if you dope system more and more, this vector decreases. If you go into underdoped region, it increases, and it would be just the opposite for this picture of stripes that was so popular at that time. So, and I would say that this was the first statement about charge modulation. It was clear statement. And then there have so several experiments have done mostly in France, and it was the first experiment done in 2011, published in Nature, and using nuclear magnetic resonance. It was done in Grenoble. The statement was that with NMR one applies a strong magnetic field, not very strong magnetic field, but magnetic field. And the point, the claim was that in this field there is a region, this was superconducting state, and there is a region where they could see some charge order. They were absolutely certain that it was purely charge order, no spin order, and therefore it was contradicting to standard picture of that time. Okay, not only at that time, that there should be the stripes, spin-containing stripes. This was some kind of religion for a decade, but there was no spin here involved, it was a charge. So they cannot really distinguish between whether it was stripe or checkerboard, but it was clear that this was a charge modulation. So it was. So we were not aware about that work already, and subsequent work when doing our work, and even after submitting to journal, we were not aware about those works, and only during.
Excuse me. So could you repeat what you said about the pattern? So they could not distinguish.
NMR somehow they couldn't make a statement. They didn't make statement. This is a checkerboard. Mm-hmm. They made a clear statement. This is just purely charge order.
And it's on static order.
Static order. But whether it is checkerboard or stripes, my feeling that after that, at least in our communication with Marc-André Julien, I guess he was saying that it was more checkerboard, but they decided not to make too strong statements when they were not so much certain about that. Anyway, it was charge order. Then this experiment was followed by already X-ray experiments, and this was a resonant soft X-ray, and it was done already in 2012, and it was the statement was clear, is clear, it is written here, that the statement of that work that they had charge correlations, and it was a checkerboard, and then the vector corresponded to the same vector I have shown you in the previous picture. It was just connecting some hotspots or antinodes. I guess it was not possible to distinguish that. But anyway, there was a charge modulation, and it was interesting that this amplitude of this modulation intensity was reaching the maximum here in the pseudo-gap state above TC at superconducting temperature. It was the maximum of this charge modulation. It was decaying to the pseudo-gap state, and it was decaying to the superconducting state, which is from our model can be easily explained. That simply here you have very strong fluctuation between superconductivity and charge modulation, therefore the signal is somehow smeared. And here simply superconductivity starts suppressing charge modulation, and therefore it decays here. And recently, just maybe a couple weeks ago, Subir Sajdev with experimentalists, they considered a different model fluctuating, and more or less just also using this our idea that pseudo-gap state is just fluctuating between different charge modulation and superconductivity. And they did it numerically, and more or less also they came to the same picture. So therefore, this experiment correlates very much with what we have proposed. Then another experiment, this is done some international group. I don't know where it was done mostly, maybe in Germany, in DAISY. I'm not sure. I do not remember simply. So again, the point was, this is just direct observation of charge modulation, and again, the claim is that they see some checkerboard pattern, and purely of charge origin, so they also could exclude spin origin. And then again, their vector was connecting these points. Then the magnetic field dependence was there, so the magnetic field, so there was no magnetic field dependence at high temperatures in the pseudo gap state, but there was some at lower temperatures. And therefore, again, this correlates to what we have predicted. Then this is just high energy X-ray diffraction. It is a different method with respect to resonance soft X-ray. Okay, not completely different, but start with different features. Then also experiment done almost here. So Lebyov is in Orsay here, and they studied sound propagation. And with the sound propagation, they have seen the following, that they have seen superconductivity here, and simply sound propagation with sound propagation, one could see charge modulation, some structure, modulated structure. And they have seen superconductivity, and here they have seen static charge order. At strong magnetic field. But this field is something like 17 Tesla. It is still much, much lower than the fields that would correspond to destroying, for example, the pseudo-gap state. That gap is extremely large. And these fields are comparatively low. And then they had just almost flat boundary for this static order, which didn't depend on field, but depended on temperature. And then it was losing, the static order was lost approximately at the same temperatures as superconductivity here. That was the fact. And also they excluded stripe order. So just analyzing their sound propagation experiment, they excluded the stripe order. This was checkerboard. Also we have done some theoretical calculation, also it's another publication. So we wrote a renormalization group equations also for this in this region in high magnetic field. High magnetic field, this means that effectively this kappa squared changes the sign. The ground state is more favorable for charge density than to superconductivity. But then one can do the same renormalization group and so on, and one could really show that in principle for magnetic fields lower, so that depends on kappa, more or less kappa squared, for magnetic field lower than this being critical, one gets superconductivity, for larger the system becomes quadrupole density wave. And then one can study also renormalization group equations in this region and in this region. In both cases, one has the transition into the pseudo-gap state. And what we got, our curve, really also there is a feature that this is almost flat and resembled very much the experimental one, and therefore we were quite happy also to compare our predictions with this experiment. That it was done quite fast, during this in the spring. Yeah. So then we have also, it's quite nice, Katrin has now a big huge possibility to talk to people that most of these experiments have been done in France and even not far away. This experiment on Raman scattering, now we also discuss how they also have some picture from Raman scattering with two pseudo-gaps, and now we see that some further development which was which we worked on in summer and also this last month, that we may be well in agreement with this two-gap picture obtained from Raman. We still do not understand this local results on neutron scattering in our picture. We don't have spin flips. Maybe this then some secondary effect with respect to this charge modulation. But anyway, we don't know what to say about this experiment yet. So therefore, this is more or less the conclusion of these lectures. So that we studied criticality, quantum criticality in anti-ferromagnetic normal metal, and we have found some mixture of D-wave superconductivity and quadrupole density wave. Instead of power law behavior with non-trivial powers, in first lectures I tried to demonstrate that this has been just conventional picture of quantum phase transition. You have like something like conventional phase transition with some scaling laws, some non-trivial exponents, but here we have seen that just at the critical point there is some new phases that appear, this superconductivity and charge modulation. Now we even have come to conclusion that even at the end of this superconductivity one can get one more new state, but this is just recent result. So therefore this criticality is much more interesting and complicated than it has been assumed below, than destruction of superconductivity at critical temperature, but still existence of pseudo-gap state, that what we have shown. The system applying the magnetic field can flip between superconductivity and charge modulation, and even more states exist, and this is ongoing study now, and we hope that also there is some new direction of new approach to study for explaining the properties of ITC cooperation. At least there are many experiments which we really can understand in quite details, and there are no other alternative theories that would really explain this charge modulation, I guess, no other. So,
Christian, maybe you could say a few words about this issue, about this rotation by 45 degrees between what was observed in experiments and the attempts of the theory community, I think. Just to put a context.
Okay, the context. So, actually, there are different angles that we got this quadrupole density wave. So one can write in this way, and these are q plus and q minus, these vectors. If you write write sine multiplied by cosine as the sum of two sines, you get modulation with the vectors half of the sum of these two vectors and half of the difference, so these vectors. And if you look into this picture, you do not know what vector is actually the periodicity. So therefore, there was quite a controversy that people, on the other hand, on one hand, really spoke about this quadrupole. It was seen, this quadrupole was seen in STM experiments. But if you make Fourier transform, and X-ray measures just Fourier transform of this modulation, they have seen just half sum and half difference of these vectors, maximum of peaks. So at first glance it is a small discrepancy, but actually it is not. And the problem, it was really that we have spent several months thinking what to do with that. Now we have an answer, and the answer is that one more transition is, and also the contradiction is that this quadrupole density wave cannot be seen by conventional hard X-ray because the Fourier transform of this thing is zero. And X-ray measures just Fourier transform. And now we have some explanation. We got some new transition on top of that transition, that this new phase transition, this is not quadrupole density wave, but charge density wave due to pairing of electrons at the antinodes, and then one gets a really discharge modulation. So this is just what we were busy last weeks also, and hopefully we will be able to write a paper on that.
It looks like nothing because it's just rotating this 45 degrees, but actually the community is stuck on that.
Yes. It is a very big.
It's due to the fact that if we take only the cupped planes, it's very constrained, actually.
But as soon as we have not written the paper, there is chance that we have find mistakes in our calculations. We'll find. So therefore, it's better not to tell too much until everything is checked and the paper is written. But I hope that it will be done soon. So therefore, everything is looks very interesting and expected, and I'm glad that my stay here within this chair Pascal was quite productive, and new ideas have arisen. All this was unexpected from the beginning. So coming here, there was nothing in our brains about working in that direction. So everything has appeared here. So therefore, I finish my lectures and I finish my stay here as Blaise Pascal chair, holder of Blaise Pascal chair. So thank you for attention.
Are there more questions?
Very basic question. It's not very clear to me. So you have this emerging symmetry between this modulation and superconductivity. How can I see that it produces some depletion in the density of states?
We considered in that previous work. It was coupling between electrons and holes, and two electrons between these opposite hotspots. And then there was a gap formed around these hotspots. Still, this region of antinodes remained free, or could remain free if superconductivity is destroyed by some magnetic field. And then fluctuations near these hotspots lead effectively to interaction between electrons and the antinodes, and this interaction leads to a new charge modulation, which may happen at temperatures below this T star, which is one more phase transition, which is also quite in agreement with several experiments. So that's the idea. But this is only preliminary thing.
Problem for the Kubretis is your Hamiltonian you start with. I mean, it's not clear how you. I mean, this spin fermion model is phenomenology. Or, I mean, how it's not really connected to the physics of how it is connected to the physics.
It's connected, but okay. Of course, until now, this model has not been derived using some small parameters or whatever, neither from Hubbard model nor from general model of cuprates, such derivation doesn't exist. Although there are good arguments that people say that Andrei Chubukov maybe invented that, that you integrate a high energy degrees of freedom, so you may start with some Kopperow lattice, for example, or Hubbard model, and you integrate first very high energies of the order of electron volts or Fermi energy, so. And then after that, you get this antiferromagnet normal metal transition. So don't ask how you get, that's another question, but nobody has doubts that there is antiferromagnet normal metal transition. Then definitely you have near this transition, you have paramagnets. So, of course, this doesn't need any microscopic justification. And then, for this low energies, still you have integrated only high energies. You have low energy paramagnets, and you have still remaining low energy electrons that interact with this paramagnet. So, this is a low energy theory. Of course, it is not just something that should explain how antiferromagnet converts into metal, because these are high energies important. And for that purpose, one should calculate numerically, for example, Hubbard model or TJ model. But if we are interested not in that, but just in the physics of superconductivity, discharge modulation, all those interesting things seen experimentally, then you may go to these low energies and study them.
It could apply to heavy fermion systems better, no?
Maybe.
In a really 2D system. So
it has to be 2D. So the gradient is 2D.
Yeah, yeah. But heavy fermions are much less anisotropic.
Of course, everything is for 2D. For 3D, all these nice effects wouldn't be there. So it's specifics.
Okay.